morning and welcome here to worship for ABK Church. It's Sunday the 7th of February. My name is Andrew and it's our privilege here as ABK Church to welcome you as we celebrate our God, as we join in fellowship, although separated, as we are in our homes and as we listen and we're not able to gather together. We know that God is with us and that we as a church of God, wherever we are, however we're feeling today, we know that God is here with us, that he loves us and that he is for us. But first up, Jill is going to lead us in a time of prayer. Let's pray together.
Good morning. Let's pray. Psalm 27 starts off with these words. The Lord is my light and my salvation, so why should I be afraid? The Lord protects me from danger, so why should I tremble? Lord God, we're gathering here today to worship you. And we ask you to grant that we may each approach your throne now, so that we might know your light shining on us and all around us. You made us a beautiful world to live in, and we thank you for all its richness. But the world can also seem like a very dark place sometimes. The things we hear on the radio and on the TV remind us all the time of the difficulties that we face and that surround us. We can feel weighed down with the worries of daily life, and the problems facing the world and its people. But Lord, will you be our light today and at all times? May your dazzling light outshine all darknesses, and may we turn to you and know personally the light of your love. May we completely rejoice in your light today, right now, and every day, and with all our heart. And as your light shines over us, may we in turn be light in this world, shining in any darkness, and helping others to see your radiant light. The Lord is my light and my salvation, so why should I be afraid? Lord, we aren't worthy to come before you at all, we know that. We're sinful people, always doing stuff that you don't like and needing your forgiveness for all the things we've done or not done. We're truly sorry. You're always the same God, whose nature is always to have mercy. So grant us, gracious Lord, your total forgiveness. You sent Jesus to be our Saviour, our Rescuer, and in him we find your loving forgiveness and a brand new start. Thank you. We rejoice that through Jesus our sins are separated as far away from us as the east is from the west. You drop our bad ways into the deepest ocean and forget about them forever. Your word tells us that you will be with us always, even until the end of the age, and that nothing can separate us from your love. We believe your wonderful promises. The Lord protects me from danger, so why should I tremble? Father God, there have been many times when you've wrapped your arms around us and taken care of us. You've sought after each of us when we were lost and brought us back into the fold. You are our shepherd, and we can stay in your loving care and never worry or tremble. We trust you to protect us and all who we love. So, Lord, please accept our praise, our love and our thanks today and use this time to feed us, correct us, strengthen us and prepare us in every way to do our best, to follow you and live our lives in a way that brings you glory. Speak into our hearts, we pray, and help us to feel close to you today. The Lord is my light and my salvation, so why should I be afraid? The Lord protects me from danger, so why should I tremble?
Let's worship Amen. God. Let's sing Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven, hymn number 160.
Praise him, praise him. So welcome, folks. I'm pleased and delighted to be joined today in a short interview by a good friend who trained with me in ministry, Ibidin. So Ibidin, how about you tell us a little bit about yourself and how you ended up in ministry in Scotland today?
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Ibidin Daramola. I'm currently the Associate Minister at Skene Parish Church. I came to Scotland about 10 years ago, and I had come for further studies. Interestingly, I had a unique research question, which I had tried with many universities, and I didn't gain admission. I couldn't find a supervisor that was interested and was willing to supervise my research, except in Aberdeen. That was University of Aberdeen. And so I got admission and I came down for further studies. And I've been in ministry for as long as maybe some 30 years or thereabout. I worked back in Nigeria. I'm originally from Nigeria. I worked back in Nigeria as a training secretary, and I worked with university students in training and discipling the leadership and the students to be able to run their fellowship effectively. And after that, I went for further studies. I studied as a counselor. I worked in Kenya as a counselor, trained as a biblical counselor and a psychologist. And then I had to come over for my PhD with my family. That's why I got to Aberdeen.
Fantastic. The two of us trained together a few years ago, and Ibidin was one of these folk that we could all rely on to bring life and soul to our training. And Ibidin is just a pleasure to know. So you have came from, predominantly Black Nigeria, and you've come to, predominantly white Scotland. Today we're thinking about Jonah chapter 4 and his view of those who are unlike him, those who are perhaps from a different culture or background than he was from. And it got me thinking all about the Black Lives Matter and protests from earlier on in 2020. And so I was wondering what your experience has been of being a Black Christian in predominantly white Scotland. Has that been a positive experience, or has there unfortunately been negative aspects to that?
I must say first that I've had good experiences. I've had friends, like you have said, we had a lovely time as colleagues training together. So it's not all bad experiences. I've had lovely time and very good friends. But also I've had instances where I have felt unwelcome in some places and in some areas, sometimes within the church, where sometimes people do that ignorantly. People say things they may not know, bother on racism, and people act in... There are some actions that, of course, were intentional in such a way that getting into a church, going to a church for the first time, and you've been there for a while, and people would not speak with you. And sometimes if you try to speak with people, they ignore you and walk away and so on. My children in particular were quite little when they came, and there was this sense of not involving them in many things within the church, and they didn't feel they belonged for a while until they kind of left and started worshiping in another church where they felt welcome, and they're quite comfortable there presently. So for when you come to a new culture and you are expecting a welcome, and for some of us who have come from Africa, for me, for example, from Nigeria, we came with a mindset of having known that we had missionaries that came from Scotland to bring the gospel to Africa, missionaries like Mary Slezer is quite a well-known one within the Nigerian context for having stopped the killing of twins, you know, there. So we felt we were coming to a mother family, as it were. These are our parents, as it were. They brought the gospel and things like that, only for you to come and feel that, oh, you're really not welcome sometimes, not all of the time. Yeah. And so some of those experiences, people uttering comments that you wonder if they knew what they were saying, or they just, and like I said, some may not have been intentional, but didn't know. I guess there's a bit of awareness that we need to create so that people would understand what it means to be racially biased and how not to do some of the things they do or utter statements that border on racism. Especially in the church, where we're meant to be a welcoming community, irrespective of who the person is, you know, or what they do.
Yeah. Thank you so much for sharing your experience there. And I'm so sorry that you've had to go through, whether it's been comments or kind of just been avoided, whether it's yourself or your family. I'm sure for all of us listening here, that doesn't make us comfortable at all. It makes us perhaps quite angry and upset that you have experienced that, and recognizing that others perhaps have felt that as well. You talk about that welcoming environment. That's something that and I'm hoping that we can aspire to our church here at ABK Church, and I'm sure across Scotland in our churches, regardless of denomination or size or type, and we would hope to be welcoming, again, not just to folk of different cultural backgrounds, but this also applies to folk, whether they're different class and society, yeah, or different or whatever it might be. We all want to be a welcoming church to those, and even to those who disagree with us, whether it's devout atheists or folk with different theology or background as well.
I think people who are different than us, sometimes people who are less privileged, maybe people who have physically challenged or challenged in one way or the other, I think as the church, we need to create a welcoming environment for people. And I'm really not blaming anyone, because sometimes we're so engrossed in our own issues, in our own challenges, that we find it difficult to notice people around us. And sometimes maybe not even racially different or in any way, but we're just caught up in many things. I guess we just need to sometimes allow some of those things to take a back seat, so that we can be aware of one another and care for one another as the body of Christ.
Indeed. What would you challenge us with? How can we as individuals, as a corporate church, perhaps as leaders in the church, be better at welcoming folk, or looking out for folk who, like yourself, might be from a different cultural background, or those who might be different to us and who come into our church community? What can we do better?
I think right from the leadership and the led, we should, well, I know that we may not be able to notice everyone within the church, but I guess first of all, we look out for the new faces. The unfamiliar faces, that may not be their first time, but even if it is, just making them feel welcome. And maybe as a congregation also, we take extra time and attention to look out for people who are new, who are different, who have not been part of the family all along, and make them feel welcome, make them feel they belong, such that by the time they are leaving the service that day, some 2-3 people would have said welcome, and they feel they are made to feel welcome, and the next time they would want to come. But when they left the service without anyone having said, apart from the minister at the end of the service, you know, just out there to say hi, and apart from the minister, no other person, not even the person sitting beside them, there's that feeling of coldness, if you like, if we say that. And if you left the service that way, you probably tried, and I've had instances where people have attended services just exploring. And by the time they came to a particular place and they found that there was no one speaking with them, they left and they never got back. And they would have gone to the next church and so on until they found places where they were welcome and they would make decision to remain there. So we need to intentionally look out for people and let them feel welcome.
Yeah.
I guess also it's important that we prepare the members, the congregation, to grow this quality, so to say, or this attribute of intentionally looking out for people.
Fantastic. Thanks so much. That's been really helpful. Yeah, Jesus, after all, was the one that went out to look for those who, I guess, had been left aside or not looked out for, and calls us to do that, whether that's in our church services when we are able to gather again, or out there in the community as well. Well, thank you so much. That's been so helpful for us, and we pray God's blessing upon your ministry as you start up there in Sweden as well. And we pray that when you do are able to meet together in person, that you will be truly welcomed by the whole church, and I know they'll be delighted to have you up there. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hope and I pray that you find that interview with Ibidin really insightful and helpful as we explored what it is to be a welcoming people. Because after all, we have a God who has welcomed us into his family. And we, as God's people, are called to be welcoming to those around us, whether they are like us or for whatever reason, or perhaps unlike us in one way, shape or form as well. And Ibidin is now going to read for us, reading from Jonah chapter 3, verse 10, right through to the end of chapter 4.
When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. But to Jonah, this seemed very wrong, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord, "Isn't this what I said, Lord, when I was still at home? That is what I tried to forestall by fleeing to Tarshish. I knew that you are a gracious God and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now, Lord, take away my life, for it is better for me to die than to live." But the Lord replied, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Jonah had gone out and sat down at the place east of the city. There he made himself a shelter, sat in its shade, and waited to see what would happen to the city. Then the Lord God provided a leafy plant and made it grow up over Jonah to give shade for his head, to ease his discomfort. And Jonah was very happy about the plant. But at dawn the next day, God provided a worm which chewed the plant so that it withered. Then the sun rose. God provided a scorching east wind, and the sun blazed on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. He wanted to die and said, "It would be better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" "It is," he said, "and I'm so angry, I would wish I were dead." But the Lord said, you have been concerned about this plant, though you did not tend it or make it grow. It sprang up overnight and died overnight. And should I not have concern for the great city Nineveh, in which there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left hand, and also many animals? May the Lord bless the reading and hearing of his word to us. Amen.
What a journey Jonah has been on. In these last few weeks, we've explored this great, wonderful story of Jonah and his life and how God used him and what God did through him. And we've seen Jonah as a rebellious prophet, as he runs away from God, heading far from the call of God. God said, go west, and Jonah went west, away off into the distance, far from what God wanted him to do. Then in the second chapter, we find him having been thrown into the sea and now in the belly of a fish, desperate for God to save him. And then last week, we find out that Jonah had been spewed up by this fish and now finally, reluctantly, made his way to Nineveh, where he preached this great message of repentance. And it wasn't just that one or two folk came to repentance, but the whole city came to know God, came to turn away from their sin, and came to trust in God himself. Whether it was a pauper or the king, they all come to know him. Now let me tell you, as a preacher of the gospel, as somebody who preaches for a living, this is every preacher's just absolute dream, that God might use one of my naff sermons to bring to faith not just one or two folk, but hundreds, if not thousands, if not a whole community or whole city. Let me tell you, if you've ever met a preacher, every preacher would love for God to use them in this kind of way. But Jonah's reaction isn't the reaction that I might have had or you might have had if something that you said caused a whole community to come to know God. Instead of delight and rejoicing at the city-wide repentance and revival, Jonah's response, as we've just found out, is one of anger and disgust and fury. Can you imagine that? A preacher who is upset that their sermon, that the words that they spoke and uttered on behalf of God have not just changed a couple of lives or quite a few lives, but a whole city, and yet is upset, angry, and even disgusted at that. It just doesn't make sense. Well, Jonah's reaction to this great repentance is a really strange one. And we see him crying out to God in prayer in verse 2 of chapter 4. He says, this is what I said would happen to you when I ran to Tarshish, he says. I know that you're a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Jonah knows from the scriptures, he's probably got at least half the Old Testament that we have in our Bibles by this point. And he knew from his personal experience of who God was, that he is a gracious and merciful God, that he is slow to anger, that he does abound in steadfast love towards people, that he is prone to relenting from destroying people. And Jonah cannot stomach that. What's clear is that Jonah is really angry that God would show compassion and mercy and grace, not to his friends, but to his worst enemies. Now remember, the Assyrian nation, Nineveh is the capital of it. These people weren't just quite bad folk. These were pretty much the worst of the worst. They were the dominant kingdom at the time. They would often threaten God's people and surrounding nations with massacres. They were disgusting, venomous, and depraved people. The entire history of that nation is filled with a reign of violence and terror and torture, of killing conquered peoples. Often they would pridefully carry home body parts of the leaders of their enemy nations as souvenirs of the war. So Jonah not only hated the people of Assyria, but he didn't want them to receive a single ounce of God's mercy or grace or compassion. Such is his anger and his disgust at what had happened through the grace of God. That in verse 3, Jonah cries out, he says, God, kill me. I cannot deal with the fact that you would save someone, that you would love someone, that you would show compassion to someone, especially not them. Jonah would rather die than let God give forgiveness and grace to anyone who's different to him. That God might show grace to people of another nationality, or especially to his enemies, to people unlike him, he would rather die. And this story happened about 2,500 years ago, far away in the Middle East. But this is not just a story that happened a long time ago, because this is a story that often happens here in Scotland in the 21st century. I've seen people who have been so incensed, so furious, that they've seen, when they've seen nice things happen to others, that they go into the spiral of utter self-destruction. That a partner or ex-spouse has now found someone else as a lover and a companion, that they just cannot stomach it. Or that some other person has become happier, got a new job or is doing well in life, and it just maddens them. So it maddens them so much to the point that their mental health suffers, or it must cause heart malfunctions in the future as well, as their blood pressure rises. Remember what Jonah had been preaching. In 40 days, you've got 40 days to turn back to God and repent. Now it seems very quickly at the end of chapter 3 that that's exactly what happened. They repented very, very quickly, right from the king, right down to the lowliest person in the kingdom. And so Jonah, in the middle of this chapter, in chapter 4, goes up to the hillside and looks over the city of Nineveh. It seems like he's sitting there, hoping that at the end of these 40 days, God nonetheless will still strike them down. God will still destroy this city, these people that Jonah hated. Now, just as God had sent the fish to save Jonah from drowning, so God now sends a large plant to cover Jonah. As he sits there in the baking heat, Jonah builds some kind of shelter, but it obviously doesn't cover him all. And so God sends this big giant plant to causes it to grow over him and gives him lots of shade. And Jonah is so glad. He's exceedingly full of joy. I'm saved by God from this heat. I'm protected by him. But the next morning, just as Jonah was getting comfy, God sends some kind of worm or bug or something to destroy the plant. And then a scorching wind comes and it withers the plant so that it no longer provides that shade for Jonah. Jonah's now suffering under the heat and exhaustion and getting dehydrated. Why does this happen? Well, God tries to send Jonah an object lesson. He's trying to make the point. He says, Jonah, you were worried all about this plant. You take pity on this plant. It's only got a leaf or some leaves and a stem. But think of all the people in Nineveh. You didn't even make that plant, I made that. But I know these people. I know even the animals in that city. And they are worth far more than a plant. And yet you care for this plant more than you care for the people. God was pointing out a gigantic flaw in Jonah's theology. He marvelled at God's goodness and grace that saved him when he was drowning, or gave him that wonderful shade when he was suffering under the heat. But Jonah thought the Ninevites were far too far from God's love, too bad to experience his care. And he forgot that he was a sinner just like them, like you and like me. That he and I and you and the Ninevites all deserved the wrath of God to fall upon them. That all of them needed God's salvation. Because all of us were deserving of God's wrath, deserving of an eternity far from God in hell. Jonah's problem is that he had forgotten that he needed grace just as much as anyone else. It didn't matter that he was an Israelite. It didn't matter that he read his Bible, that he turned up to worship, that he knew the words to hymns, that he served God in three committees in his local fellowship. He was just as much a sinner in need of salvation as anyone else. And you and I are the same. We're no better than Jonah, no better than the Ninevites. You and I are in the exact same predicament, in need of salvation. Doesn't matter how many times we turn up to church, how many hymns we know the words to, how many times we've read the Bible, how many committees we might serve on. Paul writes in chapter 2 of letter to Ephesians, for it is by grace that you have been saved, through faith. And this is not of yourselves, it's a gift from God. not of your own works, so that no one can boast about it. But Jonah was boasting. I'm an Israelite, I'm one of God's people. I'm a good guy, I deserve to be loved by God. God should be so glad that I'm on his team. After all, I turn up to church, I do the right kind of things. And sometimes in the church, we have the same tendency that we think because we've turned up to church enough times that we're pretty decent people, that we don't go around murdering folk. Well, therefore, God must be happy to have us on his team. We think that we're pretty close to the perfection of God and miles from the worst of humanity. But actually, the Bible says the opposite. It says that we are this close to the worst of humanity, and yet we're absolutely miles away from the goodness and perfection and the grace and the holiness of God. We're closer to the Ninevites than we might like to think. Too often we've been like Jonah, thinking that some other group, some other people don't deserve God's love in the way that we do, that some other cultures or peoples or society and parts of it, they should not be invited to experience the grace and the goodness and the joy and the radical love of the God of heaven and earth. Throughout my time as a Christian, whether it's been as a teenager when I first came to faith, or more recently as I trained for ministry and came into the ministry myself, there have been times when I've been utterly heartbroken, when I've heard comments from folk who are part of the church family suggesting that they wouldn't want other people, other categories, other groups of people coming to be part of their church family, as if other folk didn't deserve to hear or respond to the good news and the grace of God. There's been comments, for instance, about young people or teenagers being too noisy or not being respectful enough of the church or swearing too much. Basically, the opinion of, well, until they fix their ways, well, they aren't coming in. Or the sceptical opinions or the hostile looks offered to those who perhaps come from troubled backgrounds or circumstances, caught up in a cycle of addictions. And so when someone has walked in, perhaps under the influence of a substance, instead of love and care and compassion being offered by those who would sing Amazing Grace, people are often shunned or avoided. Hostile looks are given and shown instead. Or have been really angered by those who have themselves been annoyed that the church makes a big deal of overseas mission. It infuriates them that the church would want to spend money and pray for people who, and we would share Jesus with those who don't have the Bible in their own language, don't have church buildings or church communities in which to worship in, where there are people day after day living and dying without ever having the chance of hearing the good news of Jesus. It infuriates them that we would not spend money on their church, on their church services, on their preferences, on their churchianity. But why would you expect non-Christian teenagers who don't know Jesus and haven't been changed by him to live as if they have been changed by him? And why would you be so harsh and brutal with those caught up in addiction, as if their obvious sins are barbaric, but your sins of pride, animosity and intolerance are somehow ones that God doesn't care about? And why was it fine for poor missionaries from faraway countries to come to our wonderful country many centuries ago to tell the people of Scotland all about the good news of Jesus, but it's somehow wasteful, wrong and reckless to be spending our money and prayers and efforts on parts of the world where there are no Christians, where people don't hear about Jesus? Frankly, I've been ashamed in the past. I've been ashamed of being part of a church when I've overheard things like I've just mentioned. And if you or I have ever said things like that, if we have said things or thought things like those, we need to repent of that and ask God's forgiveness. For let me say today that all of us, you and me, whoever we are, all of us find a place in Jonah chapter 4. For either we are like the people of Nineveh, or we are like Jonah. All of us in need of repentance, all of us in need of salvation. You and I are either a Ninevite or we are Jonah. Both need Jesus, both need salvation. Are you like I am, like a Ninevite? Someone who recognises that they are a sinner, who's nothing to offer God. In fact, as Jonathan Edwards famously said, He says, you contribute nothing to your salvation except the sin that made your salvation necessary. The Ninevites knew, as we see in the previous chapter, that they really needed God, that they needed forgiveness because they had sinned greatly against God. They knew they needed a God that Jonah describes in verse 2 of this chapter, the gracious, compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love God. There was no other hope for them. Or are you a bit like Jonah, proud of your salvation, complacent in your faith, confident that God would be glad to have someone like you on the team, utterly arrogant, thinking that others don't deserve God's love in the way that you have received it? All of us today are a Ninevite or a Jonah. All of us need repentance. All of us need to ask God's forgiveness. Let me close with this. As a Calvinist, as a Presbyterian from Scotland, one of my great heroes of the faith is John Knox, the one who started the Protestant faith in Scotland and the Church of Scotland, of which we are part. God used him 500 or so years ago to bring around the people of God in Scotland back to the Bible, to the true ways of God again. He famously prayed, "Give me Scotland or I die." His passionate plea before God was an intense desire for the conversion of the people of Scotland. And he says to God, "Let me die if it doesn't happen. Let all of these people come to know you like I know you." Jonah said the opposite. "Don't let any of these people come to know you, God. I want you all for myself. I do not wish to share you. I do not want anyone else to receive your grace." I hope today that you will not be like Jonah, but that you will be like John Knox, eager that others might come to know Jesus, that those in our community, in our streets, in our towns and villages, in our whole country, in our whole world, might not come to know God for themselves. May that be our prayer. Give me Scotland. Give me my community. Give me the world, or I die. Amen. Loving Lord, we marvel at your grace towards us. We marvel that you are a God who brings us into your family. We marvel that you are the gracious, compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love God. And Father, we ask today that just as you have welcomed us, just as you have shown grace and mercy, kindness and forgiveness to us, that we would do the same to others. That we as a church should be people who are known for our love and our welcome. That we would reach out like Jesus did to the least, the last and the lost. Those who are far from you. Those who are different. Those who are unlike us. Lord, may we be your people. May we be salt and light, displaying you in everything that we are, in everything that we do. May you fill us today with all of your beauty, all of your grace and kindness and compassion, and may it shine through us as we take it into the world. Bless us, we pray, and our whole community, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. Too come alive in me.
joy to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think. According to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
So thank you so much for joining us here today as we have worshipped our God together. We pray you've been blessed by this morning's worship, and we pray that you'll be blessed this week. And a reminder that if there's anything we can do for you and to help you, then please be in contact with us. May you be blessed, and may you know the Lord's goodness and kindness, compassion and grace with you this week. And a reminder to those who are watching online that you can join us for virtual coffee right after this morning's worship. The details are upon the screen and also in the description box below. May you have a great week, and we look forward to welcoming you back this time next week too. God bless.